Hi everyone, and welcome to this tutorial bite for Oxygen Not Included, which is a quick look at industrial bricks. I will run through the two types, hot and cold, and how to set these up and manage them. Starting with the basics, an industrial brick is a community name for a design that groups industrial machines into one area. This has a few benefits, and the main one is cooling. All machines produce heat, and this needs to be dealt with. Of course, with these machines all together, they can be cooled by the same system. The next benefit is in power wire management, as the machines can be simply connected together on the high power side of a power grid, shortening the wire lengths. For a complete explanation of power systems, see the tutorial bite linked in the card. Another benefit for these designs is waste management, as some machines produce waste products, such as carbon dioxide or water. Moving straight in then, the cold industrial brick isn't really cold, but more accurately, it just isn't hot. Generally, these can be kept at a comfortable dupe temperature, for example around 20 to 30 degrees Celsius. If you want further information on how to make a cooling system, then see the tutorial bite for cooling. In a system like this, radiant pipes are recommended behind the machines, and it may be possible to use granite elsewhere. At these temperatures, Atmo suits may not be required, but petroleum generators and oil refineries may require them anyway due to their gas outputs. For the example here, I've grouped power generation, batteries, and common consumers. The metal refinery is a little special, and I've looped the coolant loop into the steam room, as I explained in the tutorial bite for plastic and steel. The aqueduct unit in here cools the turbines, as well as the whole brick. There is also a polymer press which produces steam, which can be captured as water when cooled. Natural gas generators have a small area to collect the waste polluted water. And finally in the corner, there's a liquid locked room with an oil refinery. The refinery creates natural gas which can also be recovered and used as extra fuel. Looking at the power overlay, everything is simply joined via heavy watt wire, and the material required for this is reduced by locating these machines together. There are also some transformers here to take low powered circuits into the living areas. This kind of setup is very flexible, and can be extended as much as desired to meet the colony's power and refining needs. The other kind of industrial brick is the hot brick, and how to manage these depends on what gases or liquids are produced by the machines in them, if any. But before that, I should explain that hot industrial bricks mean temperatures hot enough to make steam, so over 100 degrees Celsius, and commonly over the boiling point of polluted water, so around 125 to 130 degrees. Clearly an advantage of this is that the cooling loop is no longer required, and the whole room becomes the steam room. Note though that an aquatuna cooling loop is still required for the steam turbines. All the heat of the machinery is absorbed into the steam and dealt with by the turbines, and you can even include large heat sources like metal volcanoes or other geysers. Dupes will need Atmo suits to work in these areas, and for a guide to exosuits, there is a dedicated tutorial bite. For the machines to not overheat, they must be made of steel, so large amounts are required before being able to build this. I explained how to get started with steel in the tutorial bite for plastic and steel. Once you have enough steel to get started, it's possible to bring the metal refinery into the industrial brick, as shown here. As this is made from raw minerals, ceramic must be used to avoid overheating. Ceramic is simply made in the kiln from clay. As the temperature inside is hot, the brick needs to be insulated, and it's ideal to use a vacuum liquid lock entrance to keep the heat in. It's also a good idea to vacuum seal heavy watt joint plate connections, which I also demonstrated in the tutorial bite for liquid locks, linked in the card. A key consideration here is managing the atmosphere inside the brick. Generally, it's advisable to not build up liquids and gases inside, but instead to manage machine outputs as they are made, keeping the system stable. Therefore, the simplest type of brick has no machines with outputs to the atmosphere and only generates heat. Managing the steam level is easy in this system, and the steam turbines can return the water to the brick without changing the steam levels. The next type adds water or polluted water output to the brick, which is commonly done with natural gas generators or steam vents. By keeping the brick temperatures over 120 degrees, polluted water will immediately turn to steam, which can be collected as water, avoiding the water sieve. To ensure the temperatures are high enough, you may need to include additional heating, and I covered this in depth in its own tutorial bite. I'm showing here both methods of heating, using an aquatuna and a tricked out tepidizer. This is still a steam only brick, and the carbon dioxide from the natural gas generators is piped out elsewhere. But the steam levels will increase as more water is added. So in order to remove excess steam from the brick, some automation can be used with the steam turbine output vent. Here, the pipe continues onto water storage and the vent is controlled. The logic needs two inputs and the vent should open and return water back if the temperatures are too high or the steam pressure is low enough. Therefore, there's a thermosensor set to above 150 degrees with an OR gate to an Atmos sensor set to below 10 kilograms. Otherwise, the brick is the same. And the final type to cover is a mixed brick, which is generally steam and carbon dioxide. Note that I would recommend not including buildings or vents that produce natural gas, such as the oil refinery or oil well, and would instead deal with those separately. This kind of brick is commonly used with petroleum generators, which produce large amounts of carbon dioxide and polluted water. Using a petroleum boiler will make large amounts of petroleum, and this design simplifies the water collection as well as generating large amounts of food. As slicksters eat large amounts of carbon dioxide, it makes sense to integrate these into this brick design. By using the same ranch design trick as with hatches, a 25x4 room is used with a door and tile above, keeping them near the grooming station, and the room is made 96 tiles by blocking off one tile more. Industrial machines can then be placed in the remaining ranch areas. As the temperatures are hot anyway, it's perfect for molten slicksters, which are better as they produce petroleum instead of oil. There is some automation to explain, and going back up to the top, there is still a layer of steam which is lighter than carbon dioxide and required for cooling. Similar to the last example, there are two sensors controlling the water return. The thermosensor as before, but here the Atmos sensor is replaced with a gas element sensor which is connected to a NOT gate. This releases water back in if the steam level gets too small, and the pressure will match the carbon dioxide. To keep the carbon dioxide levels in check, enough slicksters must be used and kept happy. When using 5 petroleum generators, then 10 full slickster ranches of 8 slicksters will be needed. They must be groomed, and in order to prevent them from becoming cramped, the eggs need to be removed. A system I have created to do this sweeps the eggs into a loader, which will let them out with a conveyor shut off if there are already 8 critters and eggs inside. If not, they will come back into the room. To avoid this looping constantly, I then only activate the auto sweeper for 15 seconds every quarter of a cycle. And that's all for this look at industrial bricks in Oxygen Not Included. I hope this helps, and thanks for watching.